pass goes Taylor. Look it. He runs. He's at the 15. He's thrown. Hit in. A touchdown, Raiders.
When you have great coaches, then after you have great coaches, you get great players. You have a great organization, and you tell them one thing. Just win, baby.
Get fired up. I ain't playing. I'm telling you, get fired up. Stand up. Get out of that chair, moron. It's time for the Degos. That's right. Murph and Sonny from the Dago Dungeon. You got it right here live.
Welcome in to another fantastic episode of the Raiders Fancast. I am your host, Sonny Dego, up here in the beautifully gray, rainy, wet area of the Pacific Northwest. With me in studio, as always, is my co-host, Murph. I got it right this time. I called you Murph. You happy?
You did call me Murph. Thank you. And what an appropriate day to address me by my half-Irish last name. Well, my last name is all Irish, but I'm half-Irish and half-Italian, as you know. So thank you. As nice to be here back on the.
Did you know that the Raiders have history on St. Patrick's Day, Murph?
It is, in fact, St. Patrick's Day. And no, on this day where we trade in our silver and black for green and gold and rep our beloved Oakland A's, no, I do not know is there what the connection is between St. Patrick's Day and the. What, Raiders? Just Raiders,
right?
Let me tell.
What? Easy.
Oops. I didn't mean it like that.
Time sensitive. St. Patrick, the patron saint of Ireland, is one of Christianity's most widely known figures. We have this holiday because of him. But at the age of 16, Patrick was taken prisoner by a group of Irish Raiders. See? The Raiders have been making history forever, even long before they were even a franchise. Isn't that something?
I love seeing you make fun of me for being a Mick, especially our Uncle Mark, and or being half Mick. See, and there you go. Irish Raiders, man. That's me, Sonny. That's me.
So was Ireland the home before they were in Oakland? Anyway, we are the Raiders Fancast. Check us out on Twitter, at the Degos, T-H-E-D-E-G-O-S. The websites, thedegos.com? Is that the website? I don't even go there anymore.
Yeah, thedegos.com. D-E-G-O-S, thedegos.com. You can find all things Degos there at thedegos.com.
And then iTunes, Facebook, Stitcher, Podcast Addict, all this stuff. Just search for the Raiders Fancast. We're currently in the month of March in our giveaway, a Rich Gannon jersey. Now this isn't a throwback. You actually bought it in 2002. It's the white Rich Gannon jersey. It's not stitched, but it's still a nice-looking jersey. And I think, Murph, what do they got to do to get in the drawing for this jersey?
You know, it's a free jersey. How can you go wrong? And actually, I think I got it in like more like 2000. It was before the 2002 Super Bowl, but I think that was the last time it was worn by the aforementioned Uncle Mark. So, so it's been 15 years since this thing got worn. But and I haven't washed it. But it, no,
is there chicken wing sauce dripped on it still?
There might be a hint of ravioli and Coors Light on it, but that's I cannot deny nor confirm that. It's actually not. It's a perfectly clean jersey. It's brand new. I was going through a bunch of old Raider memorabilia, going through some closets, and came across it, and we decided to give it away. So the only thing you got to do to get the free, it's a free jersey. It doesn't cost you nothing. It's you know, whatever. Clean a table with it when you get it, or whatever. You do whatever you want with it. Because I was just gonna.
What do they gotta do to get it, Murph?
All right. Y'all aggressive. You can tell who the Italian Raider is in this dynamic duo here. All you got to do is go on to iTunes and rate us and review us, right? Just go on there and do it. But then let us know. Now, thankfully, after last show, we had some folks go on and started rating and reviewing the show at iTunes. And thank you very much to those of you that, that went out and did that. But you got to let us know because we don't know how to contact you via your rate, thereby like your username on iTunes. So shoot us a message on Twitter, shoot us a Facebook message, email us thedegoraiders@gmail.com. Any way you can reach out to us, let us know you've done it. So that way when we pick the names at random, if we pick you, we know how to get in touch with you to get your address so we can mail you this thing, okay? So that's it. So all you got to do is go onto iTunes, rate us, and review us. Sorry, Android users. I'm an Android user myself, but sorry, we don't really have a way to rate or review on Android, but I think that the next one we do, because I've found other jerseys more than just the Rich Gannon one, to give away, we will come up with something maybe for Facebook group or something to that effect. I know that there's a bunch of folks here lately that have joined in our Facebook group. So maybe we'll do it in like, you know, people that join in, whatever. Anyway, so Android users will have something coming up for you. For right now, though, it is iTunes. Go on there, rate, subscribe, review, and we will pick one at random. Let us know that you did it, and we'll send you the Rich Gannon jersey.
Murph, it's already been successful. This was your idea. I appreciate you bringing it to the show. We now currently have reviews from people who are not related to us. That was a goal. That was one of our goals, and it's happened.
That was a goal.
So we appreciate you guys. You guys rating us. That's pretty awesome. Later on in the show, we got an interview with the guy by the name of Mario Tovar, or I think that's how you pronounce his name. We'll find out. And but first, Josh, Murph, let's not talk about Vegas this week. We've given a lot of talk about Vegas the last couple weeks. Appreciate Carolina Raider coming on. That was an awesome interview.
Awesome.
And
show. Awesome
but show. There's so much other things to talk about right now. I feel like we could go on for a couple hours. So first things first, it was almost like we got a gift for our show today because we wanted to record today, and today's Friday. And I wake up – well, actually, last night, the stuff started kind of circulating with Greg Papa's cryptic. You know, the Raiders are interested in a running back who didn't even play in the league last year. And we all kind of had a sense – at least I had a sense, I'm sure you did too – that it was going to be Marshawn. And then this morning, it was all about Marshawn. So everybody's hyped. Everybody's going crazy about Beast Mode potentially coming to the Raiders. I'm a little skeptic. But I don't want to take away from what I think could be something pretty special. If you think about the fact that the Raiders are potentially moving and they bring in Marshawn Lynch, who was raised in Oakland. Well, I think he was born and raised in Oakland. How emotionally inspiring would that be if he does come to the team, regardless of how he plays, just having him on the field, having him wear the uniform? He's always worn Raider gear. He's always worn Raider swag. But then to have him come on the team, that would be a huge emotional lift, I think, regardless of how he plays. Now, if it's strictly from a how he plays point of view, I'm not too hyped on the signing, to be honest with you. He's going to be 31. He didn't play last year. His whole entire career, he's been a physical back, so he's taken hits. I'm not really sure where I land on if I want him to come or not. What are your kind of thoughts on it?
Well, first of all, he's younger than Adrian Peterson. So, you know, I know he's a physical back, but so is AP, right? And so I think that there's a couple of things that you touched on. So first off, let's talk about it from a performance perspective. On the field, what does this make sense for the Raiders? I think, yes, absolutely. We talked before that the Raiders, what they're going to – and we didn't mention it, but it's the precursor of all of this, is that Latavius Murray is gone. You know, we always called him Adrian Peterson Jr. On Madden. And now guess what? He's Adrian Peterson Jr. in real life playing in Minnesota. So, you know, that's kind of as suspected. I know some folks had the idea that he would kind of go out there and look at the market and then come home. I felt like he was gone no matter what. I mean, he's a very unique back in his size and speed, and the, you know, that's kind of a rare combination, even though his utilitarian as running backs have become, he still has a physical, the attributes and a set that is kind of uncommon. So, and frankly, I don't think it really played into the Raiders really and what they want to do on offense. So it just really made sense that he was going to go. So now we have this hole, right? We have Rashard and Washington. I think Rashard is probably going to be more of the, if there is to be a feature of those two guys, probably shake out to be the more featured of the two, but there's still going to be a need for that physical presence, that kind of a back that you can, when you need short yardage, when it's third and one, or, you know, whatever, if you're on the, you know, got the ball on the 1 yard line, you need somebody to punch it in, right? wink, wink. That's the guy that you want to have, or the type of guy that you would want to have is a Marshawn Lynch. So I think back to like what Zach Crockett was like for the Raiders, where, you know, or like what, even maybe to a lesser extent, maybe what, like what Jerome Bettis was towards the end of his career. It's like, you know, we don't need you to come in and run for 100 yards. We need you to come in and get 5 carries for 3 yards and 2 touchdowns. Like, that's the kind of thing that would be beneficial to the Raiders, I would think. And the reason that they're looking at a Marshawn Lynch is that somebody that they could bring in. And then outside of that, then the next level of that is, yes, he's a hometown guy. He's from Oakland. He's born and raised in Oakland, has flown the Oakland flag proudly all throughout his career, even as much of as he was, you know, synonymous with the Seahawks for all those years, or even the Buffalo Bills before that. You know, everybody knew it's no mystery where the guy's from. And so I think that would be cool. It also, because of the veteran presence, I think that that's something that, while Carr is clearly the leader on the offense, you can't get enough of those guys. And I think that goes understated a lot of times when you have younger teams that, you know, losing a guy like Charles Woodson, having Charles Woodson on that football team, I can't say it enough, was a big dang deal, man. Like, having that, you don't need a team to flood your team with a bunch of old veterans. You don't need a bunch of Lamar Woodleys and people like that that aren't as effective still in the field, or, you know what I mean? Like, but to somebody that can kind of have a role, a very specific role, and they're not have a huge list of expectations, and then can fill in that veteran presence and be a leader. And who's more entertaining than Marshawn Lynch too? Like, he's great, yeah, man. I'd love it. I think it'd be awesome. I think it would just be awesome. I think it fits a lot of needs for the Raiders this year.
You make a good point about, we don't need him to be a 100-yard back. The Raiders had the 6th ranked rushing attack last season, and I don't recall any time any of the 3 running backs that we ended up using had over 100 yards. Did Murray ever even have a 100-yard game last year?
I'm sure he did. I can't think of one, but,
well,
off the top of my head, he didn't have any huge games like he did against Kansas City that one year when he broke out or anything like that. But
when was that run against Kansas City? Was that last year? Or was that 2 years ago?
No, it was 2 years ago. That was the one where he took off from inside the, 10-yard line or 5-yard line or whatever.
Yeah, for like 90 yards, right?
Yeah.
I don't know.
And then he had another big one in that game. He must have ran for, I'll bet you that was like a 140-yard game or something. I know people are screaming at their devices right now because you and I don't know this stuff off the top of our head. But.
Well, they're calling out our fandom. They should be calling out our fandom here. It's not
that's okay. Good. They can call.
Anyway, so we don't need him to come in and be the focal point of the offense, which I think gives me a little bit of solace, if you will, in the sense that, yes, he is 30. He's going to be 31. But we don't need him to be the 24-year-old workhorse that he was a few years ago with Seattle and stuff like that. The other thing is that maybe the Raiders will give him the ball at the goal line and not try to throw the ball for a touchdown.
There you go.
So,
absolutely. Listen to these two stat lines right here. I'm just going to give you a quick example of what I'm talking about. When we look at Zach Crockett back to the 2002 year, all right, he had 40 attempts for 118. This is in 16 games. He played all 16 games. 40 attempts, 118 yards, and 8 touchdowns. That's the guy. That's what we need. Right there. That's a guy that's just going to pound the ball in. 8 touchdowns on 100, on just over 100 yards.
That's what you want.
I mean? Like, that guy, that's what you want. You couldn't deny that guy inside the 5-yard line. He was such a stud, man. That's what the Raiders.
Murray had 2 games over 100 yards last season. One, we were there. It was against Denver where he had 20. Remember that game? He had 3 touchdowns, 20 attempts, 114 yards. He tore up that game.
Okay.
And then the other was against the second time.
Because we were there and we didn't even remember.
Well, when you're there, you never know the stat lines. You know, that's the worst.
That's true.
And then, other time was the second game against Kansas City where you had 22 attempts for 103 yards and 1 touchdown. The biggest thing I liked about Murray, and I noticed it the most, was the first time we played Kansas City at home, and basically we got thumped by them, was he was that big presence back. He was that clock management back. He was that 3 yards in a cloud of dust back that neither Richard or Washington give us. And so while I personally was sad to see Latavius go, maybe more so from the he helped build this thing. Not so much from he was the best thing ever, because if you look at his totals, they weren't really that impressive. He only cracked 100 yards twice. He oftentimes uses 19, or one time he was at 19 yards, 57 yards, 37, 45. So he wasn't lighting up yardage wise. He did score a lot of touchdowns, but Lynch can give us that same thing down low. He gives us the workhorse, but I was sad to see Murray leave because he was here when we built it. You know, he kind of seemed like he was part of the early crew, the Carr, the Cooper, the Mac. He was part of that early crew who helped build this thing up. One thing I don't like about Lynch signing, if we do to get it, is the fact that he's older. He's only going to be here for a couple of years, and so he's not going to be part of the nucleus long term. But then you make a good point in that we don't really have that veteran who's leading the team. Maybe a little bit in Bruce Irvin, but he's still kind of a young guy. And so maybe Lynch comes in and does that, and because he's so respected in the league, that could potentially fill that void that Woodson left.
Yeah, he's instantly a leader in the locker room. There's no doubt about it. I mean, as much, again, Derek Carr, for, you know, no pun intended, he's the spiritual leader of this football team. I mean, there's no doubt, and I think Khalil Mack is becoming that. When you look at, you know, some of the rhetoric of the players, especially when you look at like what Bruce Irvin, when he refers to Khalil Mack, he refers to him as the walking
future Hall of Famers.
Future Hall of Famer and the realest, you know, in the room. Like, I mean, he's Khalil Mack is commanding serious respect from his teammates. He is already going to be a leader on this football team. You know what I mean? Like, it's already there. But yes, you have a guy like Marshawn. Marshawn's got so much credibility that comes along with him. Like, there's so much more. That's what was so cool about like Woodson, was that those guys, when you have a guy like that, they bring so much more than just I've been playing in the league or I've had success or I've won a ring or what. You know what I mean? Like, he brings like
swagger about him, dude.
Yeah, there's something. Yeah, he brings a lot more with him, and it's inspiring. It's fun. It's exciting. And then on top of all that, he can back it up too. That's the other thing too. Is it's one thing to have a guy that's funny or whatever else, or you know, entertaining to follow. But then when they can play, oh man, you know, that's when it really makes a big difference. So I'm with you, dude. I think it would be cool. Why not? Why not? What's the worst thing that can happen? Because again, it's becoming an almost interchangeable position, and we already have some young guys, you know. But it's, you know, it's a multiple back league. It's not the featured backs anymore. And you know, look at what the Falcons did this year in their running game. And you tell me, body wise, how much similarity is there between Freeman and our two guys and Rashard and Watt? You know what I mean? Like, so you can build a running game around players like that. It's, you know, look at what Darren Sproles has done in his career. You know what I mean? Or Deion Lewis. What, like, there's so many examples of that. So to just have that fill in, you know, that the LeGarrette Blount to Deion Lewis with the Marshawn to Jalen Richard. Like, I think it's great. I think it's great. And then, you know, if he's gone a couple years, he's not going to Vegas. You know, the Raiders are probably going to play at least one, if not two more years in Oakland. So he's there for that. And then, you know, he rides off into the sunset. And the Raiders moved to Vegas.
Man, how otherworldly, legendary boss status would it be if the Raiders signed hometown hero Marshawn Lynch, they win a Super Bowl, and then they dip out.
That would eclipse the whole Jerome Bettis is from Detroit thing. Remember all that, where it's like the networks wouldn't shut up about the fact that Jerome Bettis was going back to Detroit, and they were going to go and play, he's going to play in his hometown. Yada 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 yada. This would eclipse that. If the Raiders go to the Super Bowl with Marshawn Lynch, you will not hear the end of it. Which would be a great thing for us as Raider fans, but yes, that will be the absolute story of the Super Bowl, no doubt.
I would say it would.
Especially if they beat Tom Brady in the AFC Championship.
That's what I'm saying.
Oh my gosh! If Marshawn got his second shot at
the
Patriots,
that's what I'm saying.
Come on, son.
I'm getting fired up now.
I'm getting fired up now.
So boss, dude. That would be like that would be in right 10 years from now. You'd be talking about it. 20 years from now, right? That would be the Raider thing to do, and to return the Raiders to greatness, to finally win a Super Bowl after what, 30 something years, right? To have all the drama, like, would it be worth it to have suffered the 12 years of delusional Al Davis to see this moment where they sign Lynch and they go to the Super Bowl and they beat the Patriots in the AFC Championship, but you know, en route to a Super Bowl, and like, and then the Raiders ride off, Marshawn retires, becomes the next mayor of freaking Oakland, or who knows?
Yeah, he'll never buy a drink or a meal in Oakland again. Never. He will be the de facto mayor of Oakland, no matter what. Can you imagine, dude? Like,
that would be so.
Picture this, if you will. And we like to live in pretend land. In pretend land, the Raiders, there's 30 seconds left on the clock, and they got the ball. It's first down from the 3-yard line to go in for the game-winning score in the AFC Championship. Don't you know Captain Jack would run that ball four freaking times right up the gut, man? You know they would. And just, you know, throw up a middle finger to Pete Carroll and Bill Belichick the whole way. I would love it. Love it.
There is a problem, though. And I think, and I don't.
Oh, man. Back to reality.
There's always problems.
Sorry, that was fun. There's always problems.
I don't know this for sure. It was brought up earlier today, and I think it's a great point that they made. Greg Papa, we all love Greg Papa. He hinted at, you know, something big happening with the Raiders, blah, 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 blah. He kind of let in with his story and stuff on his show. He basically stated the Raiders, now I don't want to put words in his mouth, but he basically insinuated the Raiders were talking with Lynch about him coming to the team. And then Lynch, I believe yesterday, met with Seattle. I think he met with Carroll and met with the owner about being released, because technically he is still on contract with Seattle. So here's the problem with that. If it doesn't get out that the Raiders are interested, Marshawn randomly goes to Seattle and says, "Hey guys, I want out of my contract. I'm not coming back." Seattle goes, "All right." They cut him loose. He goes about his thing. Seattle doesn't know anything about it. And then Marshawn comes to the Raiders and can sign any contract. And that's just it. He's just signing a contract. And we all know Reggie does really good with contracts. Now, since it broke, it got out there that the Raiders were interested, two things happen now. One, are the Raiders tampering with a player they can't be talking to because he's still on contract with Seattle? But then two, if Seattle knows the Raiders want him, they're not going to just cut him and say, go play with the Raiders, right? Like, they're going to want something for him, at least a draft pick or something. They're going to want something in return for him. So I don't know if it's all Greg Popp's fault, but I think we should have kept this a little more under wraps.
Well, yeah, I mean, Marshawn's not – I mean, he's not the kind of guy that's going to go up and lie. He's not going to go up there and say, all right, I'm out, let me out of my contract. Because otherwise, if you're really retired, then why are you asking?
Yeah,
what does it matter? If you're really retired, then it doesn't matter. So he's not – he can't – he's not – you know what I mean? He's not going to be dishonest in that aspect of it, you know, for multiple reasons. And then but here's – will it happen from that aspect? I think that there's a lot bigger of a chance of that happening now – that they've signed Eddie Lacy versus last week when they didn't have a good running back to go to. Because remember, there was a speculation, was Adrian Peterson and blah, blah, blah. But now they got Eddie Lacy. So, you know, I think at this point, at a minimum, you're committed to him. If you're Eddie Lacy and you bring back Marshawn Lynch, what's that, right? Like, that's just a potential for disaster there. But I'm with you. Would they want some sort of compensation or whatever to release him out of his contract or to trade him somehow? Who knows? I don't know. But, you know, I don't know. I don't necessarily begrudge Papa, but I don't know if there's a good way. I think this is one of those kind of things that I don't know if there's a really super good way to handle this.
Yeah.
Thing. You know what I mean? Like, when you look at the way that Favre was when he, you know, he laid out and then he went to the Jets just so he could get freed up to go back to the Vikings when that was the whole plan all along and like all that. Like, I don't see Marshawn orchestrating anything that like that. Like, that's just not his character. He's not like a Favre that would do something like that. Remember, that was ridiculous, all that Brett Favre BS, you know, and I don't see Marshawn doing that kind of crap. So he's going to go to them. He's going to say, look, I want to go play in my hometown. You know, I want you to let me out of my contract so I can go do that. You got Eddie Lacy. You don't even need me. We're not playing in the same division or the same conference. You know, the only way we would meet would be in the Super Bowl. And I mean, would that, you know, Pete Carroll, for all the things that he could be criticized of, he's kind of a player's guy, right? Like he's all about people and he's all about his players and he kind of does the right thing always by them. So, you know, I could see him, you know, walking away from that. I mean, what have they got to lose, man? What, they don't, you know, what are they going to do with a 32-year-old Marshawn Lynch? I don't know. Yeah. Hopefully it'll happen. I don't know, but I'm with you. It makes sense. And then, you know, if it doesn't though, I don't think it breaks either one of their hearts. If he doesn't come back and or the Raiders don't get him, it's not like either one of them, you know what I mean, are going to be devastated. You know, yeah, it would kind of stink if that was a plan, but, you know, whatever. Raiders will figure something else out, and Marshawn will go on being Marshawn.
I think the hype around it's pretty fun to talk about, pretty fun to imagine. People on Twitter have already posted Marshawn Lynch in the Raiders uniform, and it just looks amazing. But let's talk about something that did already happen. Jared Cook, I'm going to ask you a question. Did Jared Cook get signed by the Raiders for a pretty decent contract because of one catch?
No.
I think he did. I think if he doesn't make that sideline catch, and you know the catch I'm talking about, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Since we don't talk about that other team on our show, we will refer to this as the catch. This is the real catch. Actually, it's probably more of the throw, because the throw was more impressive than the catch,
which is the opposite of what happened in that other one, because there's a reason they call it the catch, because the throw was trying to go out over the back of the end zone and somebody went and made the catch.
He gave up. Well,
speaking of overrated Montana, anyway, I'm sorry, did that come out? I meant to
throw power of 36. I think Cook, if he doesn't make that catch, he's not as highly regarded, right? And I guess you're a good guy to ask, because you live out there in Tennessee. You were there when he first came into the league and started playing out there in Tennessee. He's put up some numbers. He's never been over 1,000 yards, but tight ends rarely are. He only had one touchdown catch last season. In 2015, he had zero touchdown catches. But he was playing for the Rams, so I give him a pass.
And he was hurt.
Give him a pass. Well, he played in 16 games. He had started 12, had 75 targets, only 39 catches. So I don't know. He's career-wise, he's averaged 60% of the time he catches the ball. The last 3 years, though, it's dipped down to the 50s. He's 29. Is this a good signing by the Raiders?
I love capital L-O-V-E, this signing. I think this is going to be, this is my bold prediction for the year. This is such a Reggie thing to do, that while he got a pretty good contract, the amount of production we're getting ready to see out of Jared Cook is going to be, now look, is he going to be a Gronk or a Delanie Walker or anything? I don't think so. We have too many dynamic playmakers on this offense to have him be the feature. But this guy instantly, not because of the catch that he made as a Packer last year, but because of his track record, this guy instantly has the most consistent hands on our offense.
Even above Crabtree?
Yeah, Crabtree got the dropsies too, man. How many times have we seen him drop passes in the first quarter, and then finally he comes around?
First season he was kicking ass, but yeah. Anyway, go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah, but then he gets the dropsies. Jared Cook doesn't get the dropsies. This dude was a great player in Tennessee, went on and followed Fisher, or Fisher got him, whatever the case may be, got him and brought him over to St. Louis. There has never been a question that Jeff Fisher is not a good user of the tight ends. He's just not.
Jeff Fisher loves his tight ends. So,
hell. But I mean, aside from, you know, like even Frank Wycheck, as good of a tight end as Frank Wycheck was back in the day.
Ah, good call.
I mean, he didn't, you know what I'm saying? Like, and But it just, Jeff Fisher's offenses, they're all about grind, man. It's grind, grind, grind. They're not about, you know, dynamic plays by a tight end downfield like the Titans are now. And you look at Delanie Walker, and he was freaking still, even as of last year, their best player on offense. You know, like, I mean, you know, Marcus maybe now, but whatever. You know what I'm saying? Delanie Walker's a stud, man. When we went with that game that we went to 2 years ago when they played the Raiders, who was the only guy that made a play for the Titans?
Delanie Walker,
right? You know, so Jared Cook has the athleticism to do that kind of stuff. And frankly, I think the Raiders thought they were going to get a playmaker in Clive Walford, and I think he let him down. I think that even Michael Rivera showed glimpses, and we thought that maybe he was going to be a playmaker, and he kind of let him down. We got our big blocker in Lee Smith. He gets hurt last year, and all of a sudden we're playing with six offensive linemen because we're short-handed at the tight end position, and really – it's been a long time since we've had a dynamic playmaker at tight end. Like Ricky Dudley? Like, I mean, come on. Like, you got to really, like, rewind the clock pretty deep here to think about, you know, when, considering where we came from with, you know, Dave Casper and Todd Christensen. And, you know, we had some pretty amazing tight ends, or at least a couple of them, that have played for the Raiders. And we hadn't seen that in a long, long time. Now we got a guy that can make plays. He's going to get open because you got Coop and you got Crabtree and you got Seth Roberts and you got these guys are going to be able to work the ball downfield. Cook is going to be, that's going to be our red zone threat. He's going to be our first down target, third and seven. Guess who the ball's going to? Like, that's the kind of guy. He's big enough. He's going to box people out. I'm telling you, dude, this guy, he was a little hurt and he was a little underutilized in St. Louis. I think he's going to do big things under this offense. And I'm stoked, man. I think that the Raiders are going to be incredibly creative on offense this year, probably more creative than we have been since Hugh Jackson left. Because remember back those offenses when Hugh was here? It was fun, man. It was great. You know, really fun to watch. And I think we're going to get back to that. You know, I think we're going to. And then the other, and you probably, if I'm stealing your thunder here, I apologize. But then you add in Cordarrelle Patterson. You think back to when Hugh was getting all creative with Denarius Moore at the University of Tennessee. Guess what? He got the better receiver at the University of Tennessee, the faster, more physical, stronger guy. He can't really catch like Denarius could either. Neither one of them can catch. But once you get the ball in their hands, look out. So here come the reverses. I'm telling you, our offense is going to be a nightmare for opposing teams this year. Raiders are going to be kicking ass offensively this year. We're going to score 40 points a game. It's going to be like the 07 Patriots out there.
I'm going to list a bunch of names. It's good stuff, man.
Here's the recent tight ends for the Raiders. Michael Riviera, Walford, Lee Smith, currently on the team. Gabe Holmes, David Osbury, secret Madden stud. Ryan O'Malley, Brian Leonhart, Zach Miller. We love Zach Miller.
You know what? And there was a couple years there where Zach Miller was an absolute rock star tight end. I'm glad you brought him up because he was great until he got, unfortunately, injuries got the better of him. But you're right. He was an absolute stud. He was great. And really, and then I'm thinking out loud now, Marcel Reese probably played some of the best tight end for our team in the past recent years, too.
Soon to talk about Marcel Reese. Brandon Myers. Hated that guy. Kevin Boss. Nick Casa. Jaron Mastrud. Remember Richard Gordon? Richard Gordon just looked angry. Colton Underwood. Scott Simonson. Cooper Helfitt. Mickey Schluler, Tony Stewart, Kevin Brock. These are all recent tight ends that have played for the Raiders. And so you're right. We haven't had a legit tight end threat in a long time. Walford, he does okay and stuff. You know, what did he have last year? 33 catches, 52 targets, 3 touchdowns. You know, he was okay. Riviera last year only played in 13 games, 18 catches on 25 targets, 1 touchdown. So we haven't had that tight end threat. And I think you're right. And the people are starting to take notice. The Raiders are just going to outscore everybody. Like, that's what we're kind of setting ourselves up for and stuff, you know?
Uh-huh.
If you think about it, we lost Murray, who scored 12 touchdowns for us last year. But we can pick up a Blunt and fill that void. Let me rephrase this. We can pick up LeGarrette Blunt, not an actual Blunt. We got to just make sure it's scoped.
Because if you pick up an actual blunt, the only thing you're going to be filling is your stomach full of Doritos.
We know who listens to our show, so we need to clarify here. So LeGarrette Blount, if we pick up him, he satisfies that need to have that big bruiser. If we get Lynch, that satisfies that need. And really, it's an upgrade for Murray. Maybe not long term, but maybe for the next year or two. We add in Cordell Patterson, who's going to set us up better for kickoff returns. That's going to take the duties off of Rashard, so then Rashard will be more focused on being a running back and have more time and effort to focus on that spot. And we add in another tight end. Dude. And we have the chip on our shoulder from how last season ended.
Yep.
And, I mean, we were already one of the top scoring offenses already. Like, this could be fun. This could be a 40-point a game kind of fun. Now, here's my only worry. We haven't done much with the defense. We did a big thing with the defense. We got rid of Malcolm Smith. That move right there is probably the best thing the Raiders have done in free agency this whole year.
You hated that guy.
It's addition by subtraction, Murph. I'm telling you, addition by subtraction. God bless him. Hope he has a great life, great family, all that kind of stuff. But I did not like him covering tight ends. And I'm wondering if we've done enough. Are we going to be like the Colts teams where we can score a lot of points, but we can't stop anybody? Now, I know we did a lot of bend, don't break defense last year. We were near the top in turnover ratio. We did get a lot of turnovers and create turnovers. We did lose Hayden, who, you know, was turning it around, I felt. I felt Hayden was doing good towards the end of his career with the Raiders.
As a slot corner, he was playing great. He was and we talked about his physicality, man. Yes.
So I'm a little concerned that the Raiders aren't doing anything with defense. Maybe they're going to draft well for defense. I don't really know. But from a fan perspective, offense is going to be hella fun. Defense is still crossing your fingers.
Well, I think they're going to address it. I think that's you hit it right on the head. I think they're going to address it through the draft. I mean, you know, I think, as we've mentioned before, that's where this draft is going to be depth for the Raiders. Is there going to be some starting positions there? Yeah, that's sure. Absolutely. But for the most part, this is going to be our depth on defense. And it's loaded with depth. It's loaded with linebackers and corners and defensive line. I mean, or interior linemen, all the things that the Raiders need. This draft is loaded up with it. And speaking of former Titans, I think there's a good shot that they signed Zach Brown. And Zach Brown is another guy who had some great years in Tennessee, went to Buffalo, where players go to be unnoticed, and he is exactly what we were missing, I think, in Malcolm Smith, is that you called it. I swear, we were watching a game last year. I don't remember what game it was, I do remember what game it was. It was the Panthers game, and we were on the phone together during the game.
I remember.
You said, "Watch, Cam's gonna break containment, and he's gonna beat Malcolm Smith to the corner and score a touchdown." And I swear, the next play, said Hutt, Cam rolls out, bootleg, boom, runs in the end zone, and Malcolm Smith is about 5 yards behind him. And you're like, "See?" Well, here, okay, Zach Brown is.
But we're not getting Zach Brown. He left out of contract.
I'm just saying that's the kind. If we're able to backfill and sign a player that's the complete. That's what they need. You need somebody with that lateral sideline to sideline speed. Plus, I mean, that guy, I remember there was a play when he was in Tennessee, man, he picked off a pass and ran it back for a touchdown. The guy, like, in the open field, like, the guy's, like, legit with the ball. So, I think that'd be a great, like, somebody along those lines, plus all the depth in the draft, I think we're going to be fine on defense. Is it lagging behind the offense? Yeah, I think so, but only because the offense is going to be freaking out of this world. I mean, and so if you have an out-of-this-world offense with a pretty good defense, okay. I'll take that. There's been a lot of teams in recent history that have won a Super Bowl
Defense was championships.
Yeah, but you got to have an absolute – you're right, but you got to have an absolute, you know, superstar. One side of the ball or the other has got to be –
I agree. Yeah, exactly.
You know what I mean? Next level. It's either got to be offense or defense. Both of them have to be capable, but you can – if you have a stellar defense – and an adequate offense that can, especially if you can run the football, you know what I mean? Then you're great. But then, look at the Cowboys, right? Like, they have a fantastic offense. Defensively, they're kind of weak. Well, so when we look at the Raiders, I'll put up our offense against that Cowboy offense this year, and I'll take our defense over their defense. So, you know what I mean? When you think of it in those types of terms, you know, heck, look at the Patriots. If it wasn't for the Belichick factor, when you look at these our teams on paper,
we would smoke them.
Give me the Raiders. Give me the Raiders. I mean, even obviously you could the Tom Brady argument is or the Gronk argument, even if he's healthy. But outside of that, like, you name me, they're superstars on defense. You know, Dante Hightower kind of stops there. You know what I mean? Malcolm Butler, kind of. I mean, you know, Devin McCourty, I would say. Like, there's your guy, like, him and Hightower. Like, those are your two. You know, it wasn't Chris Long. Yeah, it's not Ninkovich. It's not, you know what I mean? They trade away their best guys. They trade away Chandler Jones. They trade away Jamie Collins. They get rid of those guys. It's all about Belichick and him scheming on defense. So as long as you have a good scheme on defense and you have, can make the adjustments and you got adequate talent, we've already got superstars on the – our superstars are just in the front seven. Heck, the front five, really. You know what I mean? So yeah, I think we're set, dude. I'm excited, if you can't tell.
Is it too early to talk 2017 AFC Championship game when the Raiders beat the Patriots?
I don't think so, man. I don't think so. I think for the first time in a long time, I think we are absolutely fair to discuss those types of expectations. We always do, just because we're fans and we're delusional. But I think this year, like, for real, like, I don't think there's any reason going into this year that we should not expect a healthy Raiders team to be in the AFC Championship.
So, do the Patriots signing Cooks, does that tip the power of the AFC to them? Or are we still hanging in there, do you think, with our signings? Are we keeping pace, I guess is my question.
I think we're keeping pace, but I think that they are definitely improved. There's no doubt when you add the players that they've played or that they've added and they retain guys like Hightower, which everybody knew they were going to anyways. I think that absolutely that's, you know, and I think the reason they did get him back is that, you know, Belichick's not going to trade Tom Brady, and he's not going to trade Dante Hightower. That's the quarterback of his defense. Like, so he's going to, just like he's not going to trade McCourty, or he's not going to let McCourty walk. The guy, you know, Belichick is heartless when it comes to getting rid of players. When you look at whether it's Richard Seymour or Willie McGinnis, or, you know what I mean? You look at Ty Law, Lawyer Malloy, like Troy Brown, like, you name it, man. Like, he's Teddy Bruschi. I mean, Bruschi's a little different, but you know what I mean? My point is Vinatieri. He doesn't have any loyalty. He's got loyalty to the Patriots. He doesn't have any loyalty to players. But there are some exceptions. Tom Brady's one. Now we see Dante Hightower. So retaining the players they've retained and picking up who they picked up, I think there's any argument that they've gotten better. But that said, our Raiders have gotten better too. And I will take the Pepsi challenge against the New England Patriots as of the healthy Raider team with a healthy Derek Carr. Man, especially on a neutral.
Should have already happened.
Come on, man.
Should have happened. And you know,
we was robbed.
And at this point, it's in my eyes, it's the Raiders and Patriots in the AFC. There's nobody. There's no two teams better. And yeah, we hate the Patriots. Yeah, the Tuck rule. But pull your subjective head out your butt. The Patriots are the gold standard right now. And until somebody beats them, they're it. And yeah. We're going to talk about them, and yeah, we're going to compare the Raiders to them because that is our arch nemesis right now that we have to overcome if we want to get to the Super Bowl. And if we do, I think Super Bowl's a cakewalk. But anyway, long stuff down the road, Murph. Long stuff down the road. We got an interview coming up with the guy by the name of Mario Tovar. He's not the we'll get into that in a little bit. So, Murph, anything else we need to discuss before we jump into our interview?
Yes.
We got 5 minutes.
We don't have 5 minutes. We need a 20 minutes more of show. All right. I'll pare it down and I'll tease one. Then how about that? All right. First off, two quick things and then a teaser. Number one, thank you again to Scott Winter, Carolina Raider, for coming on the show last week, and congratulations to him for becoming an accredited member of NFL media nowadays. And so that's
huge
to be celebrated. Huge. Grats to him, man. That's a big, big accomplishment. And anybody that was critical of him in the past and said, well, what have you done? Nah, there you go. There's your answer. So, grats to him for that. I think that's incredible for him. Derek, I'm going to give you one more quick one, then a teaser. Derek Carr, the Good Samaritan. Did you see the story where Derek Carr pulled over and picked up the Niners fan that was ran out of gas?
That's just Derek Carr being Derek Carr, bro. It's not a story.
Exactly.
That's who he is.
Exactly. It's so cool, and when you listen to the guy tell the story, Derek Carr was wearing a hat and some basketball shorts and T-shirt, and the guy picked him up, and they started talking about football, and the guy thought maybe he was a college player and asked him who his favorite team was, and he said, well, I might be biased because I play for him, but the Oakland Raiders. And the guy was like, oh, my gosh, you're Derek Carr? Like, how cool? Like, he's just so chill, man. He's just such a great guy. We could not ask for a better leader of our football team than Derek Carr, so that was a really, really cool story. If you haven't seen it, just Google Derek Carr, Good Samaritan, and you'll see it. He picks up a guy stranded on the side of the road and doesn't just zero pretentiousness.
It's a non-story, bro, because that's just who he freaking is, man. It's awesome.
That's just who he is. All right, so here's my tea. So starting next week, as I've told you, I've gone through a lot of my old memorabilia. I'm going through boxes of stuff
I've
gone
through
in years.
What are you, like 47? You going through your midlife crisis or what? You going to buy a new car coming up?
I got so much stuff, and I'm trying to clean things up because I have so much memorabilia, and so much, when it comes to sports, it's everywhere, man. So I'm going through stuff. Well, I came across because and I thought of this because we're doing the Rich Gannon jersey giveaway. I came across a CD that is really, really cool. Yes, a CD. That's how old this is. This is from the 2000 season, okay, the year 2000. It's called The Return to Excellence, the Oakland Raiders, and it was put out by the radio station back then, the Ticket 1050. It's hosted by Greg Papa, and what it is it's a week-by-week breakdown of the 2000 season, and it's got interviews from the players. It's got little recaps from each game. They don't cover the losses. They only cover the wins.
From what season?
So there's 14. The year 2000, so the year that the Raiders made their jump back into the playoff, the year that Tony Siragusa broke Rich Gannon's shoulder, that year.
That Tony Siragusa.
So, yeah. So, and then they went on to beat the Giants in the Super Bowl. So that year, they made it. So I was gonna play some maybe for every show from here out through the off season. We'll play a clip from this. Because it's really fun. They're short. They're only a couple minutes long each one. But we'll save that for next week because I know we're short on time. So we'll save it for next week. And we'll start off with the first one is the game against San Diego. So it's pretty fun stuff. It's pretty fun listening back, hearing Greg Papa, of course, and hear a lot of the names and hear a lot of the interviews, have a Gruden in there and all that. It's pretty cool stuff.
Nice. That's cool. All right. So check out the we'll do that after we do the interview. So coming up, we have an interview with Mario Tovar, and we'll get to that right now. All right, so please welcome in our new friend. He is not Dr. Mario Tovar, who is a PhD at South College in Texas. He is also not the Mario Tovar, who was a Mexican wrestler who competed in the Olympic Games 1952 to 1968. Nor is he the Mario Tovar who was killed in a robbery attempt in 2010. And if he is, that's kind of creepy. But yeah, he is the Mario Tovar who writes for Just Blog Baby from the Fansided Network. And he also has his own website called theraiderrambler.wordpress.com. Please welcome in Mario Tovar. Am I saying your name right, Mario?
Tovar. Yeah, it's fine. Thank Mario you for Tovar. Having me on.
Hey, appreciate it, man. Hey, real quick, where can people find you on social media and the internet?
I use my Twitter. The Twitter handle is at Mr. Capital M, last name, _87, Mr. Tovar.
Well, Mario, thanks for joining us here on the Fancast.
Thanks,
I appreciate
Chuck.
You taking time off your and joining us here. Hey, so tell us a little bit about your fandom. Tell us where you started. You know, where you're from. What you know? Sonny and I are both from the Bay Area. We were both born and raised in San Jose, and it was a family thing for us becoming Raider fans. How about you? What got you started as a Raider fan? And tell us a little bit about your background.
Well, it's funny you say that. My family's actually, was Mexican-American heritage, and all of us are based out of Los Angeles, all the different boroughs, all the different cities, and my whole family grew up huge Raider fans. I mean, L.A. Raider fans I'm talking about. So that's, you know, basically where I got it from. You know, it wasn't until I was a little bit older, maybe high school, when I started playing offensive line, that I understand the game better, you know, once you get older. And now that I'm older, you know, I just decided to take my fandom to the next level and actually started writing, you know, about it. And, you know, I'm trying to do my due diligence. You know, obviously I'm still a student, so my writing isn't quite as, you know, as where I want it to be just yet. But, you know, luckily, you know, I started my own site, so, like you mentioned, the Raider Ramble. And that was just something actually that I was doing for fun. It was actually my wife that told me, who's not a sports fan, is actually the one that told me to start doing that, just as a way of just, you know, expressing my fandom and just basically finding something to do, because I am trying to major in journalism, you know, just as a little side project. And yeah, within maybe a month, the editor over there at Just Blog Baby, you know, saw my work, reached out to me, and yeah, that's pretty much it's picked up from there, you know.
So Mario, how has social media enabled you to take your fandom to the next level?
Well, I think that's, I mean, I can speak for a lot of people when I say that social media has allowed that. You know, this isn't the old days where, you know, people were just used to the newspapers and the magazines. You know, social media has allowed me and a lot of other up-and-coming writers to just basically give us a forum, is what I'm trying to say. You know, give us a forum, reach out. In my case, you know, as far as the Raiders, Raider Nation, they have a really strong presence on Twitter. You know, my experience with them has been great. You know, some of the pieces I've written for FanSided, for some of the other sites, like Last Word on Sports and my own articles, sometimes, you know, I don't always agree with what the Raiders do, and you can be sure Raider Nation is quick to jump on that, you know. So, but it's all been positive. It's all for fun, you know. It's all good.
So you mentioned the interaction and how active Raider Nation is on Twitter, and you know we've seen that not only on Twitter but on Facebook, and we've kind of in our time and as podcasters we've seen a lot of the good and we've seen some bad and we've seen, you know, there's a lot of people in the middle, but we're definitely vocal. And so tell me, what are some of your takeaways in dealing with the Raider fan base? Something that, you know, we went from, you know, I'm old enough of an age that there was a time where my Raider fandom was expressed socially, you know, at a bar or, you know, at a restaurant or at a game or whatever. It was always face to face. And now with social media, you get access to everybody. And so it's been eye opening to me is, you know, as far as, you know, some of the differences of opinion, I'll say that to be diplomatic about it. So some of your takeaways been since you've been active blogging and in social media? Mm-hmm.
Well, you hit it right on, you know, nail on the head when you said the different opinions, because Raider Nation is very opinionated. They're a very fierce, very loyal fan base. I can't speak on other fan bases. I'm not a fan of other teams. You know, when it comes to my writing, I try to be, my goal from the very beginning was to be unbiased. You know, a lot of writers, they tend to be biased at times. And, you know, I try not to do that. I understand I'm a fan, but I put the fandom to the side when it comes to writing about any team in particular, in this case, obviously the Raiders. You know, and it's understandable. This fan base has been through a lot. I mean, just in the last 25 years alone, you know, from the losing years to the embarrassment of the Super Bowl, losing Al Davis, who was pretty much the face of the franchise since he took it over, you know, as one of the first head coaches, you know, and it's understandable. It's been a lot. I mean, I grew up in the 90s when the Raiders were kind of up and down. You know, they had a few good years, but they also had some bad ones. And then, you know, all of a sudden John Gruden took over and I lived through that. And then, whew, as an adult, I lived through the whole, the 12, 13 years of being basically a doormat, you know, and it's been hard. You know, it was hard as a fan, but, you know, so far it's all been positive. You know, I can't really complain. Raider Nation is very loyal, very fierce, like I said, but it's all been positive. I have no complaints. And social media has allowed me to share, you know, my writing more so than I could have ever had, you know, through any other venue, just because of the way people are connected now. You mentioned Facebook, Twitter, whatever it may be, Just Blog Baby through the site. You know, I get a lot of feedback on there, sometimes negative, sometimes positive, but, you know, you take it and you learn from it. You know?
What do you find are your biggest influencers for stories? Are you looking at just the team content? Is it interactions on social media? Is it a combination of a few different things? What do you typically lean on as far as your source material goes?
I try to use everything. Obviously, Twitter is the big one because I follow, you know, you follow a lot of the big name writers like Schefter and all these guys that break the stories. And all I try to do is be a responsible writer, be a respectable writer, just try to do my own take. You know, that's all you can really do. You can't plagiarize. You can't be doing things like that. You know, so all I really do is just, you know, it's a big influence. You know, hopefully I can be in the level of one of these guys one day, you know, but you got to start somewhere.
Mario, there's been a lot of talk about Vegas, a lot of division amongst Raider Nation. If you're not with us, you're against us. If and when the Raiders did move, does that affect you, your brand at all, or does that affect you at all, you know, as a fan? How would that be for you?
Well, two points of view, I guess. As a fan, it wouldn't affect me. To me, I think the Raiders are just – it's probably the only team that it's the Raiders. Yes, they've always been the Oakland Raiders, but they are the Raiders. And I think whether it would be Las Vegas, whether it was Los Angeles, I believe for a while you were saying San Antonio as well, right? So Raiders are the Raiders. I will always love them. I will always support them. I know right now Raider Nation is pretty divided on that. I mean, you can see that – you were talking about social media. I mean, you can see that every day, you know. Pretty divided, but to me it's about supporting the team. You know, a lot of people want to get into the financial aspects, the city of Oakland, what's going on with the mayor and all that, but I try to stay out of that aspect as far as, you know, getting involved with the fans. Like I said, it's a very fierce fan base, you know.
Do you think that's because the origin of your fandom was outside of the Bay Area? And like, and listen, we're like-minded. I mean, Sonny and I, you know, being from the Bay Area, we don't, obviously we want the team to stay in Oakland. That's our preference. And that's where our passion started and still remains and will always be to some extent. But do you think it's because the Raiders are more of a national or heck an international brand for that matter? Do you think that's one of the reasons why? And so maybe you fall on that type of an opinion. Is that because, you know, you're in LA, you mentioned your fandom started in LA.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess that's definitely one way to look at it. I mean, I don't want to sit, maybe it gives me more of a unbiased, more of an outsider's point of view, having grown up as an LA Raiders fan, you know. And I think LA, a lot of times LA fans, or sports fans in particular, are spoiled, and we've been called everything from, you know, unfaithful to, you know, I remember the last few years of the Raiders, I remember seeing all these documentaries. The Coliseum was practically empty, you know. Where were the fans supporting them through the tough years? And that is very true. You know, the same thing can be said about current teams. For example, the Lakers, you know, they're a bottom dweller right now, and Staples Center isn't exactly packed anymore, you know. But
yeah, Swaggy P's not pulling them in like he used to. Huh?
No, not anymore. Not anymore. So, yeah, that's definitely one way to look at it. You know, it does give me an outsider's perspective. But I think, honestly, that makes me the better writer for it. Because I try, like I said, I try to be unbiased. I try to give my opinion on certain things, try to analyze things from a certain point of view, you know.
Mario, appreciate you coming on. Real quick, do you think the Raiders get Lynch?
Oh, that's the topic of the day, isn't it, man?
Yep.
Social media is blowing up with that. Actually, I've had a busy day trying to cover that on my own.
What would that do for the Raiders and Raider Nation if he signs?
Well, look, from an entertainment aspect, it would be great. You know, I know some people on social media earlier today were trying to say that Lynch would be a distraction, he would be this and that. Last time I checked, Lynch was part of a Super Bowl winning team, which is what the Raiders are trying to accomplish. You know, any sort of distraction, I think that would outweigh it. And to tell you the truth, I really think the team, you guys know this, they really need a bruiser, especially after losing Latavius Murray. That was big, you know. And whether it's Adrian Peterson or Marshawn, they need someone, you know, someone to take that role. Jalen Richard and, you know, DeAndre Washington, they're different styles, you know. They're more to the outside, they're more speedsters, not exactly guys you're going to pound the ball with, you know. So at least not right now, and maybe in the future they can bulk up or whatnot. But they definitely need something in the short term, 1 year, maybe 2 years. And Lynch, I really think he could provide that.
Yeah, on top of just the absolute chaos that having him on the Raider Nation would ensue in the parking lot in the stands, it's already a pretty raucous environment, and it would just be that much more intense.
Well, you can tell already on social media, it's particularly, you know, Twitter where we're active, you can see fans are already having fun with it. But like I was telling, like I wrote in one of my pieces, right now it's so far speculation. You know, all we've heard is from all these unnamed sources. We've heard from Bruce Irvin, you know, putting in his 411. You know, it's
baby Reggie.
Until we hear from the men, yeah, baby Reggie. I mean, until we hear from Lynch himself or we hear from the Raiders officially, I mean, it's all speculation, you know. And I think we should just have fun with it. And I mean, if the signing comes, the signing comes, and then we can analyze that and go from there, you know.
I agree.
Hey, Mario, real quick, before we let you go, where can people find you at again and anything upcoming in your future you're working on?
Right now, like I said, that can be reached on my Twitter handle at capital M, lowercase r, Tovar underscore 87. That's my Twitter handle. I work for Just Blog Baby as a contributor. That's part of the, as you know already, the FanSided Network. And I do have my own site that I tried. I've become distracted lately. I wasn't putting as much work, but in the last few days I've become more active, and I'm really trying to get my own site, the RaiderRamble.wordpress, get my own site going, and, you know, go from there.
Awesome. Well, appreciate you coming on, and we'll have to meet up at an upcoming Raider game sometime soon.
Yes, we will. Yeah, of course.
All right. Appreciate you, Mario. Have a good day. Enjoy lunch.
Thank you, man.
Guys, thanks, Mario.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, brother. All right. Well, appreciate Mario coming on. You know, Josh, he made an interesting point. He said he tries to write from an unbiased perspective. That's hard to do in this day and age, isn't it?
Oh, my gosh. You aren't kidding, man. It's hard to talk from an unbiased perspective.
You know, everybody has an agenda. Everybody has their dog in the fight. And he's an interesting guy. You know, born and raised in L.A., an L.A. Raider fan has a unique perspective that an Oakland Raider fan doesn't have and that an outside Raider fan doesn't have and stuff, you know. So appreciate Mario coming on, appreciate his insights, and I look forward to future writings from him. Again, check him out on Just Blog Baby of the FanSided Network, and also his own blog is the RaiderRambler.wordpress. On Twitter, he's at Mr. Tovar underscore 87. Anything else, Josh Murph? Murph Josh, before we wrap it up.
And that's all I got. Thanks for joining us once again, always on the Raider Fancast. And go Raiders.
All right. Appreciate everybody joining in. Again, check us out, the Raiders Fancast on Facebook, Stitcher, Podcast Addict, iTunes. Make sure you go rate and review our show on iTunes. Throw your name in the hat for a Rich Gannon jersey. And until next time, the Raiders in free agency continue to make moves to continue to help them.
Can't wait to see the beast quake in Oakland.
Man, just talking about that got me all hyped.